praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. God, you're a great God. You are a loving God. God, it is in you that we live and move and have our being. God, I love you. I thank you for your love and your care and your concern for each and every one of us. I love you. I praise your name. God, you're awesome in your works and you're glorious in your doings. Be with us now during this time of study. Bless all of those with whom we have contact this day. Smile upon them. God, continuing to keep us in your care under the shadow of your wings. So I bless your name. I thank you for your healing touch. I bless your name. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Thank God. Amen. This is a day that the Lord hath made. And what am I going to do about it? Rejoice and be glad herein. I do greet you in the matchless name of our Lord and Master, Jesus Christ. I thank God for Jesus, our Savior, our Deliverer, Yeshua HaMashiach, the Anointed One of God, the Messiah, the Christ of God, the one who stepped out of eternity into time, coming to this earth to save us from our sins. So I thank the Lord for Jesus Christ. I thank God for each and every one of you. Our study today is taken from Luke chapter 4, verses 14 through 22. And our lesson aims are to promote the reading and understanding of God's Word. And I thank God for His Word. And you can see that in Nehemiah 8 and 8. We need to have clarity, consistent, continued clarity on the Word of God. I thank God also for the biblical teaching of eternal life. Beloved, we live forever. And we live forever in the presence of God the Father, God the Son, and the God the Eternal Holy Spirit. We live forever in a state of damnation. The choice is ours while we're here on this earth. We can choose to love Jesus and follow his commandments, or we can decide otherwise. But we need to be like a Joshua. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. I thank God also that God is great and greatly to be praised. So may God keep you in his care under the shadow of your wings. Another thing that we want to do in this lesson is to provide a brief overview of the book of Luke, to discuss the call of Jesus, comparing Isaiah chapter 61 verses 1 and 2 with Luke chapter 4 verses 18 and 19. To discuss our personal call into the ministry and to remind ourselves to have faith in the teachings of our Lord and Master Jesus Christ. Now we have a devotional reading, and our devotional reading is taken from Deuteronomy chapter 8 verses 1 through 11. And after reading that, some of the insights that I gained is that really we ought to follow every command that God has given us. And when we do, we live, we increase, we possess the promises, the benefits of the land to which God is sending us. And not only that, as we read Deuteronomy 8, we were reminded that man does not live by bread alone. And that, beloved, is why the Word of God is so important. Man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. So I thank God, amen, for his word, and I thank God for each and every one of you. God is great and greatly to be praised. Now, look at this. You know, they were 40 years in the wilderness, and in the wilderness, they're clothes did not wear out, their feet did not swell. And we're talking about 40 years. of clothing, 40 years of shoes, and God kept his people. That is to say that God provides for us. He fed them manna from on high. God provides for his people. Amen. Even as they left Egypt, Pharaoh in hot pursuit, we recognize that God is great and greatly to be praised. So much so that with Pharaoh in hot pursuit, and they come through the Red Sea, God makes a way out of no way. And this should continually remind us that God's a great God and greatly to be praised, and that God always makes a way. Pharaoh in hot pursuit, mountains on either side, Red Sea in front of them. God made a path. I want you to know today that God will make a path for you. God is great. Now, God is our Father, loves us, and he disciplines us in the same way that we love our children and we discipline them. So let us not forget the blessings of God. And as God continues to smile upon us, even in this 2021, amen, dealing with the pandemic and so many other things we've not seen before, as God continues to smile upon us, let us not forget God when we have eaten and are full. We also have a memory verse taken from Luke 4:18 and 19, and there is so much in this verse that I'll touch upon it today, Tuesday night, also this week on Facebook. I think it should be at 6 or 7 o'clock on Tuesday, but check it out. I'll talk some more about this verse, Luke 4:18 and 19, and then at our local church, the pastor superintendent asked me to speak this coming Thursday night. That'll be at 7 o'clock, and that'll be at the Good Hope Community Church of God in Christ. And I'll speak on this verse some more. There's so much in it, but Luke verse 4:18 and 19, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. So thank God Almighty that God loves you, God loves me, and we just appreciate this lesson. So out of Luke 4:18 and 19, just a few thoughts. I'll look at more in detail, but we see the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. So we got the Lord, got God, got Spirit, got Jesus talking. So then we have here, right here, in this particular verse at the beginning of it, we have right here the indication of the Trinity represented in this verse 18. And then also Jesus lets us know why he came to this earth. Amen. Preach the gospel. Amen. Heal the brokenhearted. Preach deliverance to the captives. Recovering sight of the blind. Amen. Setting at liberty those that are bruised. Preaching the acceptable year of the Lord. Jesus lets us know why he came to this earth. You know, he's talking about his ministry. And so then his calling. And I would do a rhetorical question and say, how are you articulating and following through with the calling that God has put upon you? Let us look briefly at the book of Luke. Luke, the physician, wrote his friend Theophilus to assure him that what he had heard was true. God indeed had fulfilled his promises in the life and ministry of Jesus. Luke wrote from an unknown location, about AD 70 to AD 75. Luke traveled with the Apostle Paul on parts of Paul's missionary journeys. And that's indicated by the we passages in Acts 16, 20, 27. Luke received the Christian tradition from eyewitnesses. Luke was highly educated, widely read. He was a research historian in his day. And Luke showed continuity between God's promises in the history of Israel with the ministry of Jesus Christ. Luke emphasized Jesus' compassion for the needy and the unfortunate, showed us the work of the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit. Luke used Mark and other early traditions as sources, and then we see it centered in Jerusalem as a starting point for the universal mission of the church. Now, in the summarized Bible, I just read one paragraph taken from that Bible, and I read as follows about verses 17 and 19 through 19. It is interesting to notice that Jesus stopped his quotation in the middle of a passage from Isaiah. He stopped with the acceptable year of the Lord, which is his first advent, but he knew his coming rejection. The day of vengeance of our God has to do with his second event, and he therefore omitted it at the time. Let us look at our passage of study for today, Luke 4, starting at verse 18, and going to verse 22. And Jesus, verse 14, returned in the power of the Spirit in the Galilee, and there went out a fame of him through all the region round about. So Jesus, amen. You say, where did he return? He returned, when we read the first part of this chapter 4, amen, verses 1 through 13, Jesus returned from being tempted by the devil in the wilderness. Jesus had fasted for 40 days. And after he had fasted for 40 days, Jesus was tempted by the devil out there in the desert. Amen. Devil telling him, turn this stone into bread. Telling him, you know, fall down and worship me. Amen. I'll give you all the kingdoms of the world. Being tempted by the devil. Amen. Taking him up to the high point, the pinnacle of the temple, and saying, jump off the temple and you won't get hurt. So Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit in the Galilee from being tempted by the devil in the wilderness. Amen. And the people, it says here, and they went out of fame. Amen. They went out of fame. Amen. They went out of, as it were, a report. They went out an account about Jesus Christ and his ministry. And so in this account of his ministry, the news of the ministry, one might raise a question. Well, what were they saying about Jesus? I think they were talking about healing, Jesus' healings, how he delivered people, how Jesus silenced the religious leaders, you know, the Pharisees, separated one, the Sadducees who did not believe, amen, in the resurrection. I think they were talking about how Jesus raised the dead, fed the hungry, how he set, amen, the captive free. And I tell you, if I fast forward to 2021, I can hear myself singing now, look where he brought me from. Look where he brought me from. Brought me out of darkness into his marvelous light. Look where he brought me from. So Jesus Christ was there, having been tempted, and here's a report about him. And then what was he doing? And he taught in their synagogues. Amen. Jesus, and this is imperfect tense, repeatedly instructed and imparted knowledge to the people. We need to teach the people of God, letting them know what thus saith, amen, the word of the Lord. So Jesus taught the people, and he taught them, amen, about loving God and loving the work of God. So, and he taught in their synagogue, being glorified of all. Now notice that when we're glorified, we don't glorify ourselves. We don't ascribe honor to ourselves. That's something that other people do, amen, for us. So I don't go around talking about how great I am, but other people ascribe honor and extol us, amen. So Jesus was being glorified and honored and extolled for all, by all. And I believe that he was honored and for his works, for his commitment to God. Jesus taught the people. And one thing he taught the people was about the kingdom of God. Amen. I'm talking about the righteous rule of God over all creation. You know, these last months, we've heard a lot, amen, amen, about Jesus Christ. And these last months, we heard a lot about politics. And then so people in politics, and we talk about it, democracy. Demos means people, and the people rule, democracy. Crisis meaning rule. But I love to talk about a theocracy. Theos meaning God, crisis rule. So then Jesus Christ, amen, taught about theocracy. I'm talking about the righteous rule of God. Because the kingdoms of this earth are such that they're full, amen. Bless you, Cousin Marie. Bless you, Pastor Jackson. The kingdoms of this world are such that administrations come and administrations go. Oftentimes, I use the Latin phrase ubi sunt. Ubi sunt in Latin means simply, where are they? Where are the kings of yesteryear? Think of all the great rulers in history. And some of us, we cannot even remember their names. Some of them are not even, don't even get a footnote in the annals of history. And they thought they were great in their day, and they were. But we're talking about human kingdoms that they come and they go. But Jesus Christ taught people about the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That's why we sing songs like, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. We recognize that we must, amen, consider the righteous rule of God over all creation. And I thank God that Jesus Christ taught us about the kingdom of God. Jesus Christ taught us to love our enemies. Amen, amen. Love your enemies. Amen. Regardless as to where you are in life, love your enemies. Regardless as what people have done unto you, love your enemies. Amen. He taught us how to forgive. All of us have been hurt. People have done things to us over the years. Turn it loose. Let it go. Give it to God. Regardless as to how people, regardless of how people may have treated you in life, learn to love Jesus. And that's, so he taught them. He imparted knowledge. He instructed, amen, the people of God. And Jesus was honored for his work. Now, verse 16 says, and he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. Amen. He came to Nazareth. Now, Nazareth is a town in the south central part of Galilee. This is a town where Jesus grew up. Amen. And so, you know, he'd grown up in this particular place. And so then he went into the synagogue. He entered the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as his custom was. Amen. So we need habitual, customary practices when it comes to the work, amen, of a work of God and worshiping God. Amen. Regardless as to where we find ourselves, we need a regular time for worship. I'm not telling you what time. Some of us come at 8 or 9. Some come at 11 o'clock. Some of us come both in the morning, at night. Right now with this pandemic, many of us are on Zoom. And as I was mentioning earlier, I'll be teaching at 6 o'clock on Tuesday night on Zoom, and I'll be teaching at 7 o'clock on the Good Hope Community Church of God in Christ as well. So if you get a chance, look in on us. But there's so much about the Word of God, amen, that we recognize that we must, amen, share with the people of God. So he came to Nazareth, and he had a custom. He went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and he stood up to read. Amen. Thank God for the Sabbath, a time of observance and abstinence from work. Thank God for the Sabbath kept by Jews from Friday evening to Saturday evening. Sabbath kept by most Christians on Sunday. And Jesus Christ stood up to read. Amen. He stood up to, the word is anagnonai, to say out loud, to read something that is written. And so thank God for the Sabbath. And in the Bible, the principle of the Sabbath is laid down that one day in seven is to be observed as a holy day unto God. And I don't let people judge me, oh, you worshiping on Saturday and this kind of stuff. Amen. I have to give in, amen, to those kinds of teaching, because I'm reminded, let no man judge you in respect of a holy day, a new moon, or a Sabbath day. There in the New Testament. So then we recognize that, you know, God did pause from creation there on the Sabbath, and he's showing us how to pause from all of the things and concerns and activities on this life. Jesus had a regular time for worship, and we need to do that as well. For example, this morning, and like I say, it's on Zoom, but we'll be setting up here to listen, amen, to our pastor there at Good Hope. Jesus had a regular time for worship. And I don't know why you worship at the time that you do, but my point is, it's good to have a regular time for worship. And it's good to have a Sabbath day. On the Sabbath day, we can still do good for others, because the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. On the Sabbath day, we can be free from the traditions of men, and we can come to experience the freedom of the gospel. Amen. On the Sabbath day, we can begin to understand that God wants the best, amen, for all of us. So thank God Almighty. Amen. And thank God for each and every one of you who have prayed for us, and you continue to pray for us, and just want you to know that we love you, and we thank God, amen, for you. So here we are now, talking about habits of worship, and talking about customs and customary practices, and as we consider how great God is, we ought to have an established time for prayer, an established time for fasting, an established time, amen, for ministering to others. Verse 17. There was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where he was written. Really, this word, for Biblion, really, is a scroll. And so they gave him a scroll, because this was a document that could be rolled up. And these scrolls came in various shapes and sizes. But there was given to him the scroll from the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he opened the book, really we ought to say something like, when he unrolled it, when he spread out or opened it, when he unrolled, amen, the book, then he came to the place, he found the place where he was written. He arrived at the place where he was written. So you open it up, and you know, we think of turning pages, but here with this scroll, we're unrolling it. And so he found where it had been recorded. And so where was he reading? Well, if you look in your Old Testament, he was reading from Isaiah chapter 61, verses 1 and 2. Not quite all of verse 2, but thank God for the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah was a major Old Testament prophet. He was a son of Amos. He was a man of humble rank. Isaiah's wife was called a prophetess as well. And then Isaiah lived until the 14th year of Hezekiah. And so he exercised the functions of his priestly office during the reigns of Uzziah, Azariah, Jotham, Ahaz, Hezekiah. In other words, Isaiah prophesied for a long period of time. And some people believe at least 64 years. What a long time to be in the ministry saying, "Thus saith the word of the Lord." And sometimes when the people hear the message, and agree with you, sometimes whether they do not agree, almost some 64 years, Isaiah was proclaiming the word of the Lord. And this particular passage comes out of Isaiah 61, verses 1 and 2. And I thank God, amen, for Isaiah. Thank God for his ministry. And thank God, you know, passages like Isaiah chapter 6, talk about the holiness of God. Amen. In the year the king Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord. He was high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. And guess what the angelic beings are saying? They're saying, "Holy, holy, holy." I think a lot of times we spend too much time on in the year the king Uzziah died. But this passage is really talking about the holiness of God. God is a holy God. He says, "Be ye holy, for I am holy, saith the Lord." Amen. Thank God for Isaiah. He would write passages like, "Unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. The name shall be called Wonderful, Mighty," amen, "Everlasting Father," amen. Amen. He's the king. Amen. He is a great God. Amen. And again, Isaiah particular 9, 6, and 7, we're talking about this eternal kingdom, and somebody said, thank God, amen, for his everlasting kingdom. Thank God Almighty that all of the stuff that we have gone through is going to be done away with, and we're going to have a kingdom that reflects God's love for mankind, God's righteousness, amen. And so then we see Isaiah verses 61, 62, then Luke 4 verses 18 and 19. You can compare those, but you can see the similarity between those two verses. And beloved, down in Louisiana, we sang a song about letting the Spirit lead you. And then I have some friends just all around the world. I have some friends in Mexico. I spent a week in southern Mexico there, and another couple weeks, in a week or so in northern part of Mexico as well. But I got friends down there, and in English, we sing Showers of Blessings. But I've been on Facebook Messenger with one of them already this morning. So then, Showers of Blessings. But Showers of Blessing, I feel like singing a little bit, but Showers of Blessing in the Spanish language, because we need the Holy Ghost. We need the Spirit of God raining down on our lives. So Showers of Blessing. Dios nos ha dado promesas, lluvias de gracia enviaré. Dones den fortaleza, gran bendición os daré. Lluvias de gracias, lluvia pedimos, Señor. Mándanos lluvias copiosas, lluvias del Consolador. Cristo nos dio la promesa del Santo Consolador, dándonos paz y pureza para su gloria y honor. Lluvias de gracias, lluvia pedimos, Señor. Mándanos lluvias copiosas, lluvias del Consolador. Oh Dios, a todo creyente, muestro tu amor y poder. Tú eres de gracia la fuente, llena de paz nuestro ser. Lluvias de gracias, lluvia pedimos, Señor. Mándanos lluvias copiosas, lluvias del Consolador. Obran tus siervos piadoso, celo, virtud y valor, dándonos dones preciosos, dones del Consolador. Lluvias de gracia, lluvias pedimos, Señor. Mándanos lluvias copiosas, lluvias del Consolador. Y que tenemos lluvias de gracias. May we have those showers of blessing, because we need the blessing of God. We need the Holy Ghost. We need the Spirit of God poured out upon all of us. So Jesus says here in verse 18, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised. We need the Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of Adonai, and the Spirit of the Lord, just a title for the third person of the Trinity. We need the Holy Ghost. Amen. Acts 19 verses 1 through 7. Have you received the Holy Ghost? Amen. Since you believe. Beloved, we need the Spirit of God. So then Jesus Christ begins to articulate why he came to this earth. He is anointed to preach the gospel. Amen. I'm talking about to bring the good news. And the good news is that I was messed up. The good news is that you were messed up. But the good news is that God so loved the world, in spite of where I may have found myself, that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And I tell people, thank God that I'm one of those whosoever. Amen. Whatever I may have been, God through Jesus Christ reconciled me back to God. And for that, I am eternally grateful. But we need the Spirit of God to draw us and bring us in. So Jesus Christ came to bring good news. He came to announce or convey a message of positive information. Jesus did not come to condemn us. He came to bring good tidings, glad tidings. Amen. Thank God Almighty. We have churches named Glad Tidings. Why? Good news. Amen. He came to preach the gospel to the poor, both to have few or no possessions. Jesus Christ was sent, amen, to heal, to make us healthy again, to cure, amen, whether physically or spiritually. And I just thank God, amen, for many of you, for your prayers, amen. For 3 weeks, my wife and I, amen, goddaughter, amen, we were here at home suffering for COVID, amen. And thank God Almighty, God brought us out, amen, getting my strength back, eating up everything that's in sight. And I thank God Almighty. Amen. I've been healthy most of my life. And it's no fun to be sick. I'm used to going to see about other folk. But I had folk calling me. Couldn't come in, of course. But I had folk calling me and checking up on me and dropping off packages at the door. Amen. Keeping us fed. And I praise God. Amen. From whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son. Amen. And Holy Ghost. And many calling and checking up on me, and I appreciate that. So Jesus Christ says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Amen. He came to heal. Amen. Came, amen, to heal the brokenhearted. And there are a lot of folk who are messed up. There are people who are anguished. They're devastated. They're crushed. We walk in the grocery stores, and there are folk who are despairing, and we up and down the highways. They're dejected, and they're distressed, and they're disconsolate. But the songwriter says, come ye disconsolate. Why? Because earth hath no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. Thank God Almighty. Bless you, Brother Stars. Good to see you. Amen. Thank God Almighty. So to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives. Amen. A lot of folk need to be released from whatever has them bound, not just folk in the prison. Amen. And I was prison chaplain here in the state for a while back in the 70s and 80s. Amen. And not folk who are just locked up behind bars, and not folk who are just confined or prisoners of war or exiles, but there are a lot of people locked up in their mind because they need to be set free. Amen. And so Jesus Christ has come to preach deliverance to the captives, and amen, liberating folk and from slavery and from imprisonment, other kinds of bondage. That's why I enjoy singing, look where he brought me from. There's another lady, Sister Faith, over in Yakima, when we were kids over there in Yakima. She used to get to singing, tell me, how did you feel when you come out the wilderness? Amen. Leaning on the Lord. And she'd get to dancing and singing and talking about the grace of God working in her life and how God set her free. She said, I felt like dancing when I come out the wilderness. And she had a large frame, but we were kids, and she probably wasn't not nearly as large as we thought she was, but she'd get to dancing and praising God. Why? Because God set her free from bondage. God liberated her in her spirit, and she was glad to proclaim, tell me, how did you feel when you come out the wilderness, leaning on the Lord? A lot of folk are blind. They cannot see. We need to be singing, open my eyes, that I may see glimpses of truth thou hast for me. Amen. Because God wants us to see. And so Jesus Christ came, recovering our sight to the blind. Folk need the ability to see again. Amen. Tell the blind, you can see. Regardless, you know, the devil comes to kill, steal, and destroy. The devil comes to hide the wondrous works of God from us and from our lives. But Jesus Christ has come to give us the ability to see. Amen. Amen. The folk who are bruised, amen, they're broken, they're weakened, they're crushed in spirit. But somebody said, thank God Almighty. But Jesus Christ, remember our opening statement, under the power of the Holy Ghost. So he had been tempted in the wilderness, verses 1 through 13 in this chapter. And now, under the power of the Holy Ghost, Jesus Christ declares his ministry. We need the power of the Holy Ghost. We need to consider our calling. I know, and Mother Bradford used to say years ago, I know I ain't told you nothing, but what has God told you? Well, I didn't call you, but you say that God called you. What did God call you to do? And how are you living out the ministry that God has put before you? Amen. How do you know that God has called you into the gospel ministry? How do you know that you are doing what thus saith the word of the Lord? Because many of us can do a lot of things, but what is your ministry? And so have you taken time to define what you ought to be about? Our bishop, Westbrook, used to say that wives are like the Holy Ghost. They bring everything to your remembrance. And sometimes when I'm doing several things, my wife will remind me, and we will have been married 55 years here coming up in February. Lord bless us to live. And so then she'll say, now, you can do a lot of things, but are you fulfilling the calling that God has given unto you? And I think that's a question. It's a legitimate question for all of us. Amen. Now, one thing I do know is that we are to preach the gospel. God called me to preach the gospel. Amen. I'm talking about the death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I'm talking about Jesus Christ and his teaching on the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Even as he was resurrected from the grave, went about 40 days talking about the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then he stepped on a cloud, went back to heaven. So I'm talking about his ascension going up, and I'm talking about his session, sitting down on the right hand of God, on the right hand of power. I'm also talking about our soon coming king. That's why I sing songs like, he's gone, but he's coming back again. He's gone, but he's coming back again. Well, it makes no difference what the world may say. He's gone, but he's coming back again. Father, I stretch my hand to thee. No other help I know. If thou withdraw thyself from me, oh, where shall I go? He's gone, but he's coming back again. He's gone, but he's coming back again. Well, it makes no difference what the world may say. He's gone, but he's coming back again. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. He's gone, but he's coming back again. He's gone, but he's coming back again. Oh, well, it makes no difference what the world may say. He's gone, but he's coming back again. And I thank God that I'm saved. And I see many of you, and I know you. And I thank God that you are saved. Amen. And thank God Almighty that God brought his people out of Egypt. Amen. Set them free from an oppressive Pharaoh of slavery. Amen. And we can also compare the Exodus from Egypt with what God has done for us. In the same way that he brought his people out of that physical bondage, he brought you and he brought me out of a sinful state. To that I say, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Verse 19, as I hurry on, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Now in Isaiah, he didn't go to the next one because that's his second coming, talking about the day of vengeance of our God. So he stopped right there to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. There's a favorable time. There's an appropriate time. There's a point at which certain things, amen, will occur. And Leviticus talks about this, 25 and 10, this Leviticus chapter 25, talks about this acceptable year of the Lord. And thank God Almighty for what God has done. Amen. Hermano Pastor Hilario Rojas Sotelo, que el Señor le bendiga. Amen, amen. Saludos a toda la familia. And so the acceptable year of the Lord. You see, the acceptable year of the Lord was a time when slaves were freed, debts were canceled, ancestral property was returned to the original family. Thank God for restoration. Can you imagine all of your debts being forgiven, particularly in this time of COVID and things that we are going through, and all the debts being forgiven? And so cancellation of a debt. That's a metaphor for salvation. You know, he paid a debt I did not owe. I owed a debt I could not pay. I needed someone to wash my sins away. And now I sing a brand new song, Amazing Grace, all day long. Christ Jesus paid a debt that I can never pay. Thank God that he came to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And so then we're going to have a restored kingdom. Amen. Harmony, love, and peace. I'm not going to sing it right now, but songs like There'll Be Peace in the Valley for Me. Amen. There the bear will be gentle, and the wolf will be tame, and the lion shall lie down from by the lamb, and the host from the wild will be led by a child. And I'll be changed from this creature that I am. There'll be peace in the valley for me. There will be peace in the valley for me. So Jesus Christ came to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. And we're talking about a restored kingdom under the leadership of our Lord and Master Jesus Christ. Not worrying about war, not worrying about pollution, not worrying about our continuing to destroy the ecological systems of the world, not worried about man's inhumanity and inhumane actions toward other human beings. But we're talking about a restored kingdom of love and harmony. And somebody said, praise God, from whom all blessings flow. And he closed the book in verse 20. And he gave it again to the minister and sat down. And the eyes of all them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him, versículo 20. And so he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the helper of the attendant there, and now he sits down. And notice that he stood up to read the word of God. And I don't know what your practices are, but a lot of places we stand up when we read the word of God. And then all eyes in the place were upon him. And then we ought to pay attention while the word of God is being read. And then we shouldn't be so busy that we're not listening to the man of God. And so now Jesus Christ has finished reading and everybody's looking at him. They're looking straight at him. They're gazing intently at him. They're beholding him. And in verse 21, he began to say unto them, today, this day, is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. Thank God for scripture. Amen. Now, thank God for his word. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, for instruction, righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, truly furnished unto every good work. So he began to say in verse 21, this day, this scripture is fulfilled in your eyes. And thank God for scripture, because inspiration, Greek language, theopneustos, is God breathed. So all scriptures God breathed. All scriptures coming from God. And so if God makes a statement, it has to come to pass. So then Jesus says, this day is this scripture fulfilled in your eyes. Amen. I sing songs like, every promise in the book is mine. Every chapter, every verse, every line. And I'm saved by his power divine. Every promise in the book is mine. So when we get the word of God and inspired, God breathed, if there's a prophecy in the word of God, it'll come to pass. Thank God Almighty. Jesus began to say, this day, this written text, amen, this passage is fulfilled in your ears. This day, in your hearing and your presence, this passage has come true. And for our final verse, verse 22, and all bear him witness and wondered at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. And they said, is not this Joseph's son? They were speaking well of him. They were raving about him. They were deeply impressed. Amen. They were marveled. Amen. They were amazed at the gracious words. And we ought to learn how to speak gracious words. I'm talking about words of kindness, words of goodwill, words of favor and grace. Amen. Learn how to use this tongue. Amen. For good and not for evil. Amen. The things that come out of our mouth, let them be edifying for the people of God. Amen. I bless all of you this day for sharing this time with us. And Jesus Christ shared messages of love, redemption, salvation with his people. And let us learn to do the same. And all bear him witness. Amen. They wondered at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. And yet, that second part of verse 22, isn't this Joseph's son? Amen. How did he get the, all of this wisdom, and how is he so smart? And sometimes people look at who we are and they don't believe that we are who we are. But somebody said, thank God for Jesus. Amen. Well, I'll close out by saying that Amazing Grace, as you know, is my favorite song. And if I were going to sing another song, it'd be like at the cross, amen, where I first saw the light, amen, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. I thank God Almighty for each and every one of you. Songs like Come Ye Disconsolate, already mentioned, every promise in the book is mine. When I think about what God has done for me, I just say I look back and wonder how I got over. Songs like I Stand Amazed in the Presence of Jesus the Nazarene. I sing songs like Libre, Tu Me Hiciste Libre, Free, You Set Me Free. And since yo veo al Pastor Hilario Rojas Sotelo, and he's from Mexico, I'm going to sing this last song for him and for his people there. And they treated me so nice when I was there. At the cross, at the cross, at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Mirio el pecado fui a Jesús, mostrele mi dolor. Perdí derrante vi su luz, bendijo en su amor. En la cruz, do primero vi la luz. Y las manchas de mi alma yo lavé. Fue allí por fe, do vi a Jesús. y siempre feliz con el seré. Oh, at the cross where I first saw the light and the burden of my heart roll away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Well, God bless you. And again, on Tuesday night at 6 o'clock, I'll be teaching on Facebook. I'm going to continue with this a series on the book of Luke, actually. On Thursday night, I'll be speaking at Good Hope, a Community Church of God in Christ at 7 p.m. And then on the third Sunday, thank God for my nephew, Christopher Beffley. Deacon Beffley is going to be teaching on the third Sunday at this time at 8 o'clock. I look forward to him. I have some wonderful nephews, Pastor Jackson, my nephew Chris, and thank God Almighty for them and their love for the Lord. Well, God, we thank you for this day. Be with us now. Bless these so great a people. Take what has been done here and let it use for your glory and your honor. Te lo pido en el nombre del Padre, del Hijo, del Espíritu Santo, por siempre y jamás. Amen. And all the people of God said amen, amen, and amen. Have a wonderful day in the Lord.